Hi, my name is Chris, and this is Battle Nonsense. Today we will take a look at the Netcode of Darwin Project, a battle royale game made by Scavenger Studio, which you can get for free on Steam. In case that this is the first time that you watch one of my videos, I want to say welcome to my channel, and please watch my Netcode 101 video first or right after this one to learn more about tick rates, update rates, network models, super bullets, lag compensation and packet loss, as well as a few other things like how I do my network delay tests. The reason why I no longer include this basic information in every netcode analysis is not to get you to watch more of my videos. I've created this Netcode 101 video as my patrons and subscribers requested that I should keep the actual netcode analysis as short as possible. So the card overlay in the top right corner, as well as the link in the description down below, will both take you directly to that Netcode 101 video. Now, first of all, what kind of network model does this game use? Since you surely followed my advice and watched the Netcode 101 video first, you know that there are basically three different network models. Client-hosted matches or listen servers, where one of the players is also the host. Peer-to-peer, where all clients talk to each other and run their own synchronized simulation. And dedicated game servers, where the clients only talk to the game server, which runs the simulation. Considering that there are only 10 players and a show director, the developers could have been tempted to use the listen server or client-hosted matches network model. But luckily they did go with dedicated servers instead, which as far as I am able to tell, are only hosted on Amazon's cloud platform AWS. However, while Amazon has data centers in these locations here, Darwin Project currently does not seem to take use of all these data centers, as the region selection only allows you to choose from these 6 locations. So if you don't live near one of these, then you will probably have to play at a quite high ping, which means that you won't have a good online experience in this game. Which is why I think that the developers should consider to also use other hosters to fill the gaps where AWS does not have any data centers yet. Now, before we dive deeper into the networking, I want to show you 2 settings in this game, which, in my opinion at least, every game should have. Number 1 is the frame rate limit slider, where you can choose any value between 30 to 300 FPS, which is especially useful for those of us who have a G-Sync or FreeSync display. And number 2 is that you can not only select a voice chat input device, you can even select an output device for the built-in voice chat feature, which means that if you capture or stream this game, then you can put the voice chat output on a separate audio track, which gives you a lot more control over that audio source when streaming or recording your gameplay. If you want to learn more about how you can put the game audio, VoIP and your microphone on different audio tracks, then you can find links to 2 videos in the description down below, where I show you how you can do that using OBS, digital audio cables and the new audio setting that was included in the April update of Windows 10. Now, how about the update rates at which the clients and the servers send and receive data? When we look at the network data captured with Wireshark, then we see that the server sends 30 updates per second to the client, which means that the server probably runs at a tick rate of 30 Hz. The send rate of the client, however, is directly linked to its frame rate. So when you play at 200 FPS, then your client will send 200 updates per second to the server, while when you lock your frame rate at 120, your client then sends 120 updates per second to the server. And when you lock your frame rate at 60, then your client sends 60 updates per second to the server. Now, while it is possible to further reduce the network delay by using a client send rate that is higher than the tick rate of the server, it doesn't make much sense to have the client send more than 60 updates per second when it receives just 30 updates per second from the server. When your client sends 160 or even more packets per second, then this can even have a negative impact on your online experience, as packets per second can become a limiting factor before bandwidth, as we've seen in the past with Quake Champions. So, while players should absolutely be able to play a game at 200 FPS or even more, I think that the developers should not allow the client to send more than 60 updates per second when the game runs at a tick rate of 30 Hz, to avoid that the send rate of the client causes issues for the players. Now, how much bandwidth do you need to play Darwin Project? So, when you play at 160 FPS, then the client sends 160 updates per second to the server, which causes that the game needs quite a bit of upstream bandwidth, as you can see here. However, if your connection can handle a game like Battlefield 1, then Darwin Project should work just fine. Now, if you have played Darwin Project, then you might have noticed this overlay in the lower right corner. This value here seems to tell us the server's send rate of 30 Hz, but I have no idea what these other 2 values stand for. If you know more about these, then please leave a comment down below. Then we see the network latency here, which is higher than the ping that you see for your connection to the AWS data center, as the latency value is based on the game data and thus will include the processing delays of the client and the server. The game does not have any sort of network performance icons that would show up when there is an issue with your connection to the game server. However, the latency value here will turn red as soon as it exceeds 183 milliseconds. That said, it would also be nice if the text could turn orange between 90 to 183 milliseconds, because your online experience will already suffer as soon as your latency is higher than 90 milliseconds. Another very nice detail is that in the second line of this overlay, you get the name of the AWS data center that you are connected to, so you always know where that server is located. Now, how much network delay or lag are two players affected by when they play on the same server at a ping of 16 milliseconds each? In my network delay tests, I measured an average damage delay of 46.2 milliseconds, an average gunfire or arrow delay of 52 milliseconds, and an average movement delay of 53.2 milliseconds. So, when you compare these results to those from other games, then you must keep in mind that I had to run these tests at a ping of 16 milliseconds, since the European servers of Darwin Project are only hosted in Frankfurt, to which I have a ping of 16 milliseconds. But even when you keep that in mind, Darwin Project shows quite decent results, which is why the online experience is quite good in this game. Now, how about the lag compensation, which usually causes that players who have a low ping to the server receive damage far behind cover when they get shot by a player who has a high ping to the server? If you have played Darwin Project, then you know that while there are cases where you feel that you were hit behind cover, it is not as bad as it is in other first or third person shooters. In Darwin Project, it's actually quite tricky to hit other players when you have a ping of more than 100 milliseconds to the server, because at a higher ping there is a noticeable delay between pressing the left mouse button and shooting an arrow, as you can see here in these examples. And that's all for today. If you want to try Darwin Project, then you can find a link to the Steam store in the description down below, and if you give it some time, then it might start to grow on you just like it did for me. That said, I want to make clear that this was not a sponsored video. I did not get paid by Scavenger Studio to test this game, nor did I talk to anyone who is involved in the development or marketing of this game. So, if you enjoyed this first netcode analysis for Darwin Project, then it would be great if you could support me on Patreon, because without the awesome support that I get from my patrons, Battle Nonsense could simply not exist anymore. You can find a link to my Patreon in the description down below, where you will also find links to my social accounts in case that you want to stay up to date on the videos that I'm working on. So if you enjoyed this video, then please give it a like, subscribe for more, and I hope to see you next time. Until then, have a nice day and take care. My name is Chris, and this was Battle Nonsense.